So this is something which you people are familiar with because you have studied the first two heads of income, that is salaries and house property. So in this semester, as I mentioned in the preceding class, we will be discussing the remaining three heads in addition to the remaining three heads, which constitutes your first three chapters. You would also be studying deductions under section 80C to 80U, which is your fourth unit, and fifth unit is assessment of individuals. So in income tax, any chapter begins with definitions, because especially in law subjects, if the definitions are not clear, this can lead to consequences, lawsuits filed in various courts, unnecessary complications, and therefore a well-defined definition will avoid all these conflicts. So let's see what business is according to Income Tax Act 1961, Section 2, Subsection 13. So Section 2, Subsection 13 defines, it does not say business means, but it rather gives us an indication that business includes the following components. So first, business includes trade, and you're familiar with the concept of trade. It's a process of exchange. But here the point which is worth noting down is, from the perspective of income tax, this trade has to be purely carried out with an objective of making profit, because in some cases trade remains only a process of exchange. In some forms of trade, even forget about profit, money is also not involved. Traditionally we had barter trade, but now a new form of barter trade is emerged, which is widely practiced in international business, and it is called counter trade, right? I'm sure you guys have studied international business recently, and you know what counter trade is. Counter trade is again a form of barter trade, but it's a little more advanced version. So sometimes in trade, there is no money involved. But here when we say trade from the perspective of income tax, trade should also have an objective of making profit. Second, commerce. So commerce is a broader term, and in sometimes commerce is also referred as trade carried out at a very large scale, but it is also defined as trade and aids to trade. So commerce is primarily concerned with trade, and it also includes aids to trade. Now when we say aids to trade, it basically means all those factors which are necessary to carry the process of trade. Trade cannot be carried out without support functions. So some of the support functions needed to carry out trade includes your transportation, warehousing, storage, marketing, human resources, banking, insurance. Without the support of all these elements, you cannot carry out commerce. So commerce means both trade plus activities that facilitates trade. And the third one is manufacture, which is quite easy to understand and something which you people are familiar with. So manufacture is a process of converting raw material into a finished product. So it's a process in which you do some sort of fabrication to ensure that the product is usable or is ready to use. So that process is called manufacturing. But here the first three terms which are listed out seems to be quite easy to understand. What is quite complex is the last term. As we go in more deep into the chapter, you will understand why adventure seems to be a complicated concept in the definition of business. So when we say adventure, it means an isolated transaction outside the assessee's line of business, but it is in the nature of trade, commerce, and manufacture. Now to explain you guys what adventure is, let me give you an example. Let's say I own a manufacturing unit. I have a manufacturing unit which is primarily used in the manufacturing of garments. So in order to manufacture these garments, assume that I have a couple of machines which I have purchased, and in my factory, let's say there are five machines. So I'm using five machines in my factory to carry out the process of manufacturing. Now, unfortunately, on account of various reasons, let's say lockdown, my factory is not operating at its full potential capacity, which is capable of operating all the five machines. Due to low sales, lesser demand, I'm using only three machines. And the remaining two machines remains unproductive. I'm not using it at all. So that's the nature of my business. So by looking at the definition, what kind of a business do I do? Is it trade? Is it manufacture? Or is it commerce? The answer is a combination of all the three. Only by manufacturing goods, I can't store the goods in my warehouse. It has to be sold. So therefore, I am also engaged in the activity of trade. Now, in order to carry out the trade, I also need the support of auxiliary services like transportation, warehousing, marketing. So therefore, the kind of business what I am doing, in fact, all the three components of business, which is defined under Section 2, subsection 13 is applicable for me. I am a manufacturer of garments and I do all three. I do trade, I do commerce, and I also do manufacturing. So that's the situation. Now, these two machines, which remains unproductive in my business, what I'm planning to do is somehow I want to generate income out of these two machines, but unfortunately there are no sales. So I come up with an idea that why not let me give this machine on hire to somebody else, to some other manufacturer who has the capacity, but unfortunately does not have the machine. So I do a listing on OLX stating that I am willing to give my garments manufacturing machine on rent. So if somebody is interested, please contact me. So luckily, in a few weeks, I get a lead and somebody calls me and says, okay, I'm also a manufacturer of garments. And luckily, I have good sales. I'm into exports also. So I need your machine on rent. So let's negotiate. So after the negotiation, we come to a conclusion that, okay, fine, you can take my machine for manufacturing of garments. So we draft an agreement. And there are so many other terms and conditions in agreement, but the bottom line is that I have given the machine on rent on a monthly rent of 30,000. Now the machine which was unproductive for me, which was not generating any kind of revenue, is now generating a revenue of 30,000 per month for me. So now I want to ask you a question. The question is the 30,000 rupees what I'm earning by letting this machinery on hire, by letting this machinery on rent to somebody else, is this a business income or is this not a business income? What do you think? Because my primary line of business is manufacturing, and section 2, subsection 13, if you guys look at the definition, as you can see here on the slide, it clearly says that what I do is a part of business. So manufacturing, trade, all this is a part of business. But what I've done now, which is letting the machinery on hire, is this income from business or not? So the answer to this question is, this can be considered as an adventure. This transaction constitutes an adventure, which means it is, see, my business is manufacturing garments. I'm not into the business of letting machines on hire. That's not my business. But income tax department says this can be considered as an adventure because this is something which is not what you do on a routine basis. On a routine basis, I make clothes. I manufacture clothes. So that's my business. That's my routine business operation. But letting the machinery on hire for others is not a part of my business. That's not my business operation. But what income tax is saying, that such transaction which is not directly connected with you, with your business, something which you do not do on a routine basis, can also be considered as business income. But this is not in the form of trade, commerce or manufacture. This constitutes an adventure. So such transaction is classified as an adventure. So adventure is a transaction which is not directly connected with your routine business operation. So therefore, this becomes income from business. Now, let me recall the transaction, what I was telling you guys. So my business was not doing well. So I decided to give the machinery which I'm not using on hire, and I was generating revenue for it. Now let's say things go worst. Now I'm in trouble because I'm not able to generate cash flows on account of poor sales and account of lockdown. So what I've decided is that let me sell this machine itself. It's not just giving the machine on rent, which I tried earlier. and it worked to some extent because I was getting regular rent. But now things have become so bad that I'm in need of so much of cash that I've decided to sell the machine itself, which I bought it for 2 lakh rupees. Now I'm selling this machine for 1,80,000 rupees. In this case, it is a loss. Assume that luckily I got a customer who is willing to pay me more than what I've purchased for. Since this is an imported machine, it's not available in India. So I found an import. I found a customer who's willing to buy my machine for 2,25,000. So in this case, it's a profit because I bought this machine for 2 lakhs and I'm selling this for 2,25,000. Is this income from business or this is not income from business? What is your opinion? Why don't you guys give your comments in the chat box? What do you think? Is this income from business or not? The first one, letting the machine on hire, I was a manufacturer, business was not there, so I thought, okay, let me give this machinery on hire and I was generating rent. So according to income tax department, that is income from business, even though it is not at all related to what I'm doing. I was a manufacturer, but I gave the machinery on rent. It is nowhere connected to my main line of business, but income tax department says it is an adventure, so therefore it is also income from business. But here in the second situation, I have sold the machine itself, so the machine itself no longer exists, so I have made profit by selling the machine. Is this income from business or not? So the answer to this question, this is not income from business. Why is this not income from business? The reason why this is not income from business is because we have another head of income tax called income from capital gains. Now, what income from capital gains says is whenever you buy and sell an asset and if you make profit out of that asset, any profit made from buying and selling of asset, not current asset, fixed assets, intangible assets, fictitious assets like goodwill. So any profit made from selling non-current assets, in other words, fixed assets, intangible assets, or fictitious assets, will be taxable under the head capital gains. So the profit which I made by selling the machine, which was used by me in the business, right? Technically, you should have said this is also kind of a business income. But since for such transaction, we have another head of income called capital gains. So therefore, that would go under the head capital gains. It will not be considered as income from business. So I'm sure now you guys are clear what is income from business as per section 2 subsection 13. So as per section 2 subsection 13, the term business includes trade, commerce, manufacture, and most importantly, which you have to understand, is adventure. So adventure in the form of trade, commerce, and manufacture is also considered as income from business. Now, some of the essential features of business, something which this is not defined in Income Tax Act, but these are important features which would help us to understand the law well. So point number one, now there are people who indulge in I wouldn't be using the word unethical, let's rather use the word illegal. Because unethical practices are something which have become a regular part of business. So let's ignore them and let's talk about illegal business. So what do you think illegal business? Is illegal income also taxable like legal income? Let's say I am into smuggling. So I smuggle goods. I smuggle goods from Dubai and I sell them in India. So the entire modus operandi, the entire model of business is totally illegal. But is this illegal income or is also taxable? Or do you think only legal income is taxable? So the answer to this question is that, in fact, Income Tax Department does not bother whether your income is legal or illegal. Whether your business income is coming from legal business model or illegal business model, you are liable to pay tax. Now that's quite confusing because does it mean that Income Tax Department is endorsing people to do illegal business? The answer is no. What Income Tax Department says is in case if you are caught doing illegal business, because generally people who do illegal business, they do it in a concealed manner. They don't reveal it. The entire operations, business operation is undercover. They don't tell that they're doing illegal business. But what Income Tax Department is saying, in case if you are caught, let's say somebody is doing smuggling business and he's caught finally. He's doing it for the last 10 years. And for the first 9 years, nobody knew that he's doing illegal business. And finally, he's caught by the police authorities red-handed doing illegal business. So what the income tax authorities say is that you are liable to pay tax for all that money what you have made from illegal business. So what would happen here is income tax department would carry out the proceedings and ask the SSC to disclose all the transactions what he was doing for the last 9 to 10 years. So in all those transactions, income would be identified. The SSC has to pay tax on illegal income to income tax department. So income tax department will take that tax. All that income, what the SSC was earning all this while, all the assets of the business, all the properties of the business will be seized or confiscated by the government. And SSC will go to jail. So income tax department will take the tax. Income will be taken by the government and SSC will go to jail. So this is what would happen in case if somebody is doing illegal business and caught. So the point here is income tax department does not differentiate legal or illegal income. As far as there is income, it is taxable, whether it has been earned through legal means or illegal means. The only difference is in case if you have earned the income through illegal means, if you're caught, you are carried out, you have to pay the tax on that illegal income. And further, you have to surrender the income also to the government and you would go to jail. Another interesting point which I wanted to discuss is the regularity, right? Now, let's say I have done business, but only once. Let's say I have a big plot of land, probably 100 of acres, which I inherited from my grandfather to my father and my father transferred it to me. So I have this land. So what I'm planning to do here is, what do I do with such a big land? So what I do is I convert this acres of land into small plots, each plot with a dimension of 1,200 square foot or 3540 site, and I sell them. That's it. After which I've never done any business in my life. That's the only one time I did this transaction. I'm a salaried employee. So what I did, I got land free, inherited from my father. I subdivided that land into small plots. I sold, I made profit. Am I taxable under the head income from business? Should I have to pay tax? Or can I claim that, see, I've done this only once. I am not doing it on a regular basis. Right? Because when you say business, generally business is carried out on a routine, regular basis. It goes on forever, right? For a long duration. So can a one-time transaction, which happens only once, can this also be considered as business? Or do you think, in order to consider any transaction as business, should there be a regularity? Should there be a routine operations that needs to be carried out? So what is your opinion? So whatever might be your opinion, right? Income tax department says business can be part-time, it can be full-time, it can be on-time, it can be regular or it can be irregular, doesn't matter. So the bottom line is, as far as you have done trade, commerce or manufacture or adventure, even if you have done it only once, still that transaction constitutes business and you are liable to be taxed under the head income from business. So regularity of transaction is immaterial. So whether the transaction is regular, continuous, doesn't matter. As far as there is an element of trade, commerce or manufacture attached to it, it will be considered as income from business. And as I mentioned, whether business is legal, illegal, organized, unorganized, does not matter. Now, you might be wondering, all those small vendors who sell goods on roadside, right? It can be hawkers, right, who carry articles from one street to another street on their heads or in some sort of carts, or pavement vendors who set up stalls on footpaths. Should they also pay tax or are they exempted from paying tax? Now, would you say that since they are part of unorganized business, they are not entitled to pay tax? Now, what do you mean by organized business and unorganized business? The answer is organized business requires a trade license. organized business requires you to register under GST, which you people have recently studied and forgotten. Point number three, you should file your tax returns. Whether you're earning profit or you're suffering loss, you have to disclose your income to income tax authorities. If you are doing all these three things, then your business is classified as an organized business. License, GST, filing of returns, income tax returns. All these three things is not done by the people who do business on the roadside. A Pani Puri vendor does not have a trade license from BBMP to do business. A Pani Puri seller does not register under GST. And most importantly, he is not filing his tax returns. So therefore, it becomes unorganized. So if a person is doing unorganized business, is that person exempt? Does he come under the ambit of business or not? The answer is even he will come under the ambit of business. Even that is a business, even that is a trade. It is just that there is no system of monitoring or there is no system of collecting tax from this unorganized traders, unfortunately in India. And don't be under the assumption that these people who do trade on roadside, street side, they are poor. By and large, right, they might look poor, right, they may struggle, but there are people who do better than what organized businesses are doing. There are Pani Puri sellers who make more money than what KFC or McDonald's does, right? But unfortunately, government of India is not able to collect tax from them because we do not have a proper law to bring these unorganized traders under the ambit of taxation. So bottom line, business can be legal, it can be illegal, it can be organized, unorganized, doesn't matter. Everybody will come under the definition of Section 2, Subsection 13, and they are entitled and liable to pay tax if they earn money. And lastly, one of the important essential feature of business which we can derive from the Section 2, Subsection 13 is that profit motive is a must. So the element of making profit is one of the important element, otherwise it will become a non-profit organization. Right. So these are the three essential and important features of business. Right. Now, let's also discuss some of the other concepts which are discussed under Section 28. What has happened is even though Income Tax Department has come up with a definition of business, unfortunately, that definition, what Income Tax Department is using, which is Section 2 subsection 13, is not a comprehensive definition of business. It's not a comprehensive definition of business. And therefore, what Income Tax Department has done, it has introduced Section 28 to inform people that in case if you do not come under Section 2 subsection 13, there are many other transactions also which are also taxable under the head income from business. So anything which does not come under Section 2, Subsection 13, anything which does not come under the definition of business will come under Section 28. So if you are doing a transaction which comes under either Section 2, Subsection 13 or which either comes under Section 28, it is taxable as income from business. Now, in the previous class, we had a brief discussion that how do you classify a particular transaction under a specific head? How do you say this is salary, this is house property, this is profit and gains from business and profession? So I was telling you that we have to always look at the basis of charge or the defining criteria for classification. So I mentioned that if you want to consider any transaction as salary income, if you want to consider any transaction as salary income, then one of the important criteria defined in the respective section is that you need to have employee and employer relationship. And if there is a relationship, employee and employer, that transaction will be classified as income from salary. So similarly, if you want to classify any transaction as business income, that transaction should either appear under the definition of business defined in Section 2, Subsection 13, which says business includes trade, commerce, manufacture and adventure, or it should come under Section 28. So what it means is that the term business is not just limited to Section 2, Subsection 13, but the word business has a broader scope And that scope is what we are about to discuss now. What are the transactions, excluding what is defined in section 2, subsection 13, which is still taxable as business income? So first is something which we have gone through. Any income earned from any trade, commerce, manufacture, and adventure. Let's discuss some of the other transactions now, which constitutes business income. So first, technically in this list is export incentives. Now, export incentives are monetary and sometimes non-monetary and sometimes a combination of both, given by the government of India to export-oriented organizations. Enterprises engaged in the business of exports, they are incentivized. Now, you might be wondering why would government would give incentive to business, because government is rather dependent on business to collect tax. So it's not that always government wants to collect tax. Sometimes government also wants to promote a certain type of business because that type of business might be quite helpful for government. Now, why government wants to promote export? For a simple reason that export would give the government the most valuable resource, and that most valuable resource is foreign exchange. Foreign exchange is very important for the economic growth. Foreign exchange is very important for strengthening of the local currency, right? In fact, in India, we follow a system of reserve. The notes are printed. You might be wondering, why can't we print as many as notes as possible and fulfill the requirement? The answer is we can't print as many as notes we want because it has certain economic implications. But one of the important criteria which Indian government follows for printing notes is that our system of printing notes is backed by a reserve system. So the more foreign exchange reserve we have, the more gold reserves we have, RBI gets the freedom of publishing more currency notes. So therefore, foreign exchange is very valuable for the economic growth of the country. And export is a type of business that brings in that valuable foreign exchange. So therefore, government of India is willing to incentivize all those companies which are engaged in the business of exports. So let's say I am an exporter, I export mangoes. Right? I export mangoes to Europe and some other countries in the world, some other countries. So every kilo of mango what I export, on that the government will give me certain cash incentives. So let's say for every kilo of mango what I export, government gives me 10 rupees. Government gives me 20 rupees. So that's my incentive. So technically speaking, I have earned some income. The incentive what the government is giving to me, technically speaking, it is a kind of an income. So what kind of income is this? Is this salary? No, I'm not working for government. Is this house property? Not possible. Is this other sources? Can be. But since income tax department clearly says that this is an item that will come under section 28. So the moment it comes under section 28, it will be classified as income from business. So therefore, export incentives, even though it is not a direct income related to trade, commerce, manufacture, or adventure, but still export incentive received from the government constitutes income from business. So tomorrow you cannot claim that, okay, export incentive is not a trade, it's not a business, it's not commerce, it's not manufacture. So therefore, income tax department is quite smart and they have already included the word export incentive under section 28, making it clear that if you receive export incentive, it is also income from business. And it is quite logical. Why are you receiving export incentive? Because you're doing export business. So why don't we consider this as export incentive, right? Quite simple. Third, profit on sale of import license. Now, what is import license? You're familiar with it. Import license is a permit given by the government of India to import goods from other countries to India. Without having an import license, you cannot bring anything inside the boundaries of India. If you do so, it is called smuggling. It's illegal. So if you want to legally bring some article, commodity, product inside the geographical boundaries of India, you need to have a license, you need to have a permit. So that is called import license. Now assume I am one of the leading phone manufacturer, Xiaomi or Redmi or just me, who is primarily dependent on China to get the raw material. Even though Xiaomi has its plant here in Andhra Pradesh, where the phones are made locally, but despite of the phones are being made in India, right, the material still comes from China, something which that something which cannot be avoided at the moment. So Xiaomi, let's say, has import license to import raw material from China, and we are Xiaomi, right? Now, what has happened is, let's assume I have the import license to import 1 lakh components of raw material. And during the year 2020, out of this 1 lakh, the import quota, what the government has given to import certain number of articles is called import quota. So as per my import license, I have an import quota of 1 lakh units. Now, what has happened, unfortunately, because of my poor sales and my poor performance and a lot of marketing flaws, I have used this import quota only to an extent of 50%. That means I have the capacity to import goods worth 1 lakh, but I've used only 50,000. Remaining 50,000 of quota is still there as it is. And I don't see any revival in the sales. Unfortunately, my sales seems to be very, very poor, and it continues to be because of poor marketing strategy. So what has happened? One of my competitor, he approaches me and he says, okay, anyways, my quota is exhausted. Even I had 1 lakh quota, but since my sales are extremely good, I have exhausted all my quota, right? So can you give me your import license so that I can import the raw material using your import license, and I can import the raw material in return? Don't give it to me for free. I will pay for you. So you give me the permission to use your import license. I will pay for you. So let's say I have agreed to give my import license to my fellow businessman, and using my import license, he imports. But I tell him that, okay, every component you import, you have to give me 50 rupees on that. So let's say I'm making a whopping profit of 25,000 rupees by selling this import license. Is this income from business? The answer is, as per section 28, this is also income from business. So this also constitutes income from business. So not just export incentives, profit on sale of import license is also considered as income from business. Then you also have income derived from professional, trade or similar association. Now, business generally has associations which are constituted to help the entire business fraternity. I'm not sure how many of you have heard of NASSCOM. It's a very popular body for software and call center industry, also known as ITS, Information Technology Enabled Services. So NASSCOM stands for National Association of Software Companies. So this is a trade association established to help what type of business? ITS, Information Technology Enabled Services. So I can become a member of NASSCOM. By being a member of NASSCOM, after paying membership fees to NASSCOM, the moment I become a member of NASSCOM, I am entitled to get certain benefits from NASSCOM, right? One of the benefits is that NASSCOM will represent and negotiate on behalf of all the businessmen with the government. But there are some tangible benefits also. NASSCOM also operates a software which maintains a record of all the employees who work in software companies and also in call centers. So let's say I'm one of the employee who started his career with Accenture, and in Accenture, I've done some bungling. I've stolen their hard disk. I've stolen some customer data and I leave the job. Now, tomorrow I might go and work in some other company, and some other company will not be able to figure out that I had actually stolen some data in the previous company. I might go and work in different city in India. They will not be able to trace me. So in order to avoid such issues, NASSCOM came up with an employee-based data in which if an employee is caught doing some sort of an unethical practice, unethical thing, immediately the centralized database maintained by NASSCOM gets updated. So tomorrow, if the company, let's say Accenture is a member of NASSCOM, and tomorrow I'm applying for HP, and HP is also a member of NASSCOM. So before recruiting me, HP will do a background verification. They will access a NASSCOM database and figure out if I've done any kind of mischief in my previous companies. So if you want to use that software, which is developed by NASSCOM, you should be a member of NASSCOM, National Association of Software Companies, which is actually an association or a trade association. So, like this, NASSCOM is also making profit. But NASSCOM may claim that I'm not doing business. I'm just helping people who do business, but I'm not into business. But income tax department says, okay, you're not into business, but your business is helping other business. So therefore, the income what you're earning is also income from business as per section 28. So income derived by a trade or a professional or a similar association is also a business income. So they cannot say that they are into helping businesses and therefore they are not entitled to pay income tax under the head income from business. They are also doing business as per section 28, and they are also taxable under section 28 of Income Tax Act. So income of trade association is also taxable under the head income from business. Now, some of the other very interesting transactions, and this is something which is quite interesting. Now, perquisites you have studied in salary, it's a non-monetary benefit offered by an employer to employee. It's a non-monetary benefit. It is not in the form of cash, it is in the form of kind. Can a businessman also receive perquisite? You may be wondering how. Because as a businessman, if I give perquisites to my employees who are working in my shop or who's working in my company, but who will give incentive to me? The answer is yes, why not? Right? If you're a businessman who's operating a store, right? You also get incentivized from various wholesalers and brands. So you go to a medical store, he would have displayed you all the products in a showcase which belongs to a particular brand. Let's say Johnson and Johnson Clean and Clear face wash. Now, the moment you go and buy a medicine, you see that the window is full of Johnson and Johnson Clean and Clear face wash, which is being clearly displayed in the showcase. So for doing that, this medical shop guys gets paid by whom? By the distributor. So by doing this, he gets paid, let's say, 5,000 rupees a month. So is this income from business? Now he might say, boss, I didn't get this from buying and selling medicines. I got this as an incentive from my wholesaler. So why should I consider this as income from business? But income tax department clearly says, if you are a businessman, if you have received any perquisite from your distributor, wholesaler, brand, that is also called income from business. Or that is also called income from profession, something which doctors do. Right? Now, whenever you visit a doctor, doctors are very smart. They get paid a lot. It's not just they get money from consultation, but they get a lot of money from pharmaceutical companies. Now imagine there's a big difference about the prescription protocol which is followed in USA and in India. In USA, if I visit a doctor, if I'm having a fever, what doctor will do is doctor will write the generic name of medicine. And at the time of buying that medicine from a medical store, I get to decide which brand of paracetamol I want to buy. But in India, unfortunately, what happens directly, doctor only will write the brand name. Imagine I'm unwell. I visit a doctor and doctor says, okay, gentlemen, you have to eat chicken. The more chicken you eat, you'll become stronger and your immunity will increase. But rather than writing chicken, doctor has written, gentlemen, you have to go to KFC and eat 3 times. So why is the doctor favoring KFC? For a simple reason that there's a direct connection between doctor and KFC. So same thing happens in case of pharmaceutical companies. Here in India, doctors, instead of writing the generic name of medicines, instead of writing paracetamol, he clearly writes, okay, take Dolo 650. Now, Dolo 650 is a product of Microlabs. So why has he written Microlabs? Why did he not write some other brand? Obviously, that there is a connection between brands and doctors. So pharmaceutical companies lure doctors by offering them various incentives. They clearly tell doctors, you give us so much of business, we will send you on a world trip. We will give you a BMW car. We will give you a washing machine. We will give you an LED TV, but you have to give us so much of sale. And that's the nexus which operates in India. Every time you visit a doctor, he will not only give you a branded medicine of his choice, he will write the brand of his choice. Not only that, but he will also prescribe you needless medicines. You would have gone for a simple fever, but he will also write vitamin D, zinc, all that, which is not necessary at all. Why? Because for every medicine, what he writes in the prescription, he is getting a lot of incentives and benefits from pharmaceutical companies. So that is what Income Tax Department is saying. In case if you get any benefit or perquisite from your supplier, wholesaler, distributor, that is also income from business or profession. So if my total, let's say I'm a doctor, my total income is 10 lakhs, but during that year I got a BMW car, from pharmaceutical company for prescribing medicines, and the worth of BMW car is 50 lakhs. So now my income will become 10 lakhs plus 50 lakhs. Total income will become 60 lakhs. Right? So income tax department is smart. Right? So don't assume that they're fool. And that's the reason why I said, if the definitions are incorrect, if the definitions are not clear, there is a possibility this will lead to a lot of conflicts and court cases. So that's the reason definitions have to be very crisp. So any value of benefit or perquisite received by a professional or by a businessman is also taxable under this particular head. Another point with which we'll probably summarize today's class is any sum received or receivable for non-competition and exclusivity. So there are two things here. One is non-competition and the other one is exclusivity. So let me talk about exclusivity first. What is this exclusivity? Exclusivity is an agreement in which one party gives right to another party, but this is an exclusive right, which means one party grants rights to another party, and that rights will be given only to one entity in the entire country or in the entire region. Right, in the entire region, it will be given only for one particular entity. Now, in order to get that exclusivity, I have to give extra money. Now, let's say I want to take up a franchisee of Burger King. Right, I am Domino's. You guys are aware of Domino's. Now, Domino's in India, the exclusive right for the franchisee is given to a company called Jubilant Foods. So Jubilant Foods is a company which is listed on stock exchanges in India, which has exclusive rights of operating Domino's stores across India. So they have given, they have been given exclusive rights. On the other hand, McDonald's does not give it, has not given any exclusive right. If you want to open a McDonald's store, you have to contact McDonald's and they'll help you to set up a store. But in case of Domino's, it's not like that. If you want to open a Domino's outlet in India, then the exclusive right is given to Jubilant Food. So you have to contact Jubilant Food. So for that exclusivity, so if you want to set up a franchisee, let's assume the fees is 50,000 rupees, or let's say the fees is 50 lakh rupees. But if you want exclusive rights, then you have to pay extra. For that extra exclusive rights, that is also a kind of income. Let's say I'm BCCI. And one of my copyright, one of my trademark, or one of my patented product is IPL. So who has the copyrights to broadcast IPL in India? Who has been given the exclusive rights? The exclusive rights is given to Star Network, Star Sports, right? But why I didn't, why, what made me to give that exclusive rights? I would have given rights to at least three channels. Why only to Star? I would have given the rights to three channels. So if I'm telling Star, if you want exclusive rights, give me extra. So let's say the value of the entire IPL five seasons, the value of the entire IPL five seasons is 8,000 crores. But I'm telling Star, give me 2,000 crores extra for exclusive rights. For giving rights to broadcast the matches, 8,000. For giving you an exclusive right that only you should broadcast this match and nobody else should do. That means if tomorrow a news channel wants to show a small clipping on their news channel, for that also they have to pay Star, right? So they get exclusive right. Nobody else can, right, even take one picture out of the match which is going on, for which Star has given me 2,000 rupees extra. So what income tax department is saying, if you are making money from exclusive agreements, from the exclusivity like this, for that also is taxable under the head income from business. Now, what is this no competition clause? A no competition clause is a concept wherein you cannot compete with a certain entity. Now, what happened, to cut short, you know, the story of Coca-Cola. Coca-Cola was present in India during the 70s, but in 80s, what happened? The government of India came up with some conservative rules which did not allow foreign companies to do business in India independently. So government of India says, okay, all the foreign companies, if you want to do business in India, you have to partner with an Indian company. Indian company and foreign company should do business together. Coca-Cola did not like this because they didn't wanted to share their business secrets, so they left India. But in the year 1993, when India became a globalized, liberalized economy, they came back. But when they came back, the situation was very tough. Right, Pepsi was struggling in India, was not able to sell any product. Coca-Cola was also not able to sell any product because the champion of India's carbonated beverage segment at that time was Parle. Parle's product like Thumbs Up, Maaza, Limca, Sprite were doing extremely well. So Coca-Cola had no chance to sell anything in India. So what Coca-Cola did in the year 1994, they bought all the brands of Parley. So they bought Limca, they bought Maaza, they bought Thumbs Up, and they also entered into a no competition clause. What if Parley, after selling all these brands, starts another new cold drink business after 1 or 2 years? Again, Parley will become my competitor. So I don't want any competitor to be there in the market. So what I'm doing is I'm not just buying all the brands from Parley, but Coca-Cola also entered into a no competition clause. And as for that no competition clause, Parley will not do cool drink business for the next 20 years. So from 94 to 2004, Parley did not even sell one cool drink. Right? Except for Appy, because Appy was not purchased by Coca-Cola, and Appy was a fruit juice, but the agreement was for carbonated beverages. So immediately after 2014, when the agreement exhausted, immediately Parley came up with a new product called Cafe Cuba, which did not do well in the market. But since Appy apple juice was doing well, they made Appy Fizz, which is again a carbonated beverage, which can compete with Coke, Pepsi, and any other brand. So this is called exclusivity, and this is also called non-competition. No competition clause. That means you, for signing an agreement that you will not compete with me, I'm giving you an extra cash. So Coca-Cola paid, let's say, 800 crores for all these brands. In addition to this 800, it has also paid another 500 for ensuring that you never compete with me for certain duration. So this is called no competition clause. So what income tax department is saying, in case if you get any money by signing an exclusive agreement clause, if you get any money from by signing no competition clause, that will also constitute income from business. Okay, so what is income from business? The answer is, income from business as per Income Tax Act includes two components. One, it includes Section 2, Subsection 30. Okay, so there was some network issue in between. I think it's rectified now. So let me just summarize what is business according to Income Tax Act. So the business has two important dimensions. One, we have to go by the definition, Section 2, Subsection 13, that tells income, a business means trade, commerce, manufacture, and adventure. Then we should also scrutinize Section 28, because Section 28 has additional list of transactions which are also classified as income from business. So with this, we will conclude today's class. If you guys have any questions, you can raise your hand so that I can unmute you.